My name is Rick Telberg for CPA Trendlines, and I'm thrilled as punch to be able to present today Eileen J. Kennedy, client experience and business development expert at the Kennedy Factor. Eileen is a leading client experience and business development advisor, consultant, and keynote speaker specializing in the accounting, financial services, hospitality, and not-for-profit sectors. She helps firms deliver a consistent, exceptional, customized, and memorable client experience, and she's got the bona fides to prove it. She spent 5 years as the first client experience director at a top 25 accounting firm. She's spent 7 years as the owner consultant of her own firm, the Kennedy Factor. She's an entrepreneur in her own right. And she had a 20-year career at Merrill Lynch, eventually rising to the position of the first national manager of over 7,500 employees in the U.S., Latin America, and Europe. I can't think of anybody better qualified to talk about client experience in the age of COVID. Eileen J. Kennedy, thank you. Welcome. Take it away.
Thank you so much, Rick. It's an honor to collaborate with you. It's been an absolute joy being able to pull this session together with you. So I love the way you introduced the part about my personal mantra being consistent, exceptional, customized, and memorable client experience. Each of those four words are so important when you look at client experience with client eyes. We're going to turn things upside down today, and everything I talk about is from the client's perspective, not ours. So let's kick it off with what Rick loves the most, how you're going to make money if you actually implement these best practices. Due to COVID-19, oddly enough, as business people, we've been given the opportunity to become more relevant in our clients' businesses. If you follow the 80-20 rule, you will make more money and you will retain your best clients. I'm going to give you some ideas on how to wow your clients, and especially using client feedback, which is critical to your business, using that feedback to grow your business and gain referrals. So there's just three items in the table of contents. We're going to look at the coronavirus thought leadership. We're going to take a look at the current state of your business. And then I'm going to introduce you to some tools that I call the Kennedy Factor paradigm shift. So coronavirus thought leadership, I'm giving you two slides. You will have access to the slides and these links will be live for you. Of these resources from the CPA Trendline website, I want to focus on one. It's called the New Rules for Online Meeting, and we will talk about that towards the end of the webinar. With some other resources, including reflections from the AICPA chair, you may have already read it, but go ahead and take a couple of minutes. It's pretty powerful on how to deal with the disruption from the coronavirus. But I want to kick this off with the emerging stronger than ever, because it's all about our mindset and how to actually embrace this disruption. So the article says you can thrive for years to come if you take this as a wake-up call for your business, and you've already had two things that have started to have the client see you as a business partner, as an advisor in their business. The second one is so critical. How do we survive in the future, and how do we have long-term growth in this new world that we're living in? But here's the more important part. The article talks about changing your mindset about the way you run your practice. So one of the things about changing behavior is the recipient of the new behavior gets a little suspicious. If you are treating me differently in January 2021 than you ever have in the last 15 Januaries, I'm going to be a little suspicious about why you're changing your behavior. So I'm giving you an excuse to use COVID as your first excuse on why you're changing your behavior, but go ahead and use me too. Position me as either a business coach or a program that you attended. Blame your changes on me and COVID. So let's see if we can actually start to do that. So I'm going to start with two definitions. The first one is, what's the definition of insanity? You're probably used to it, and you probably know who said it. Albert Einstein is credited for saying you're expecting different results, and all you're doing is the same thing over and over again. So that is truly insane. The next definition is of a paradigm shift. I told you my tools are called the Kennedy Factor Paradigm Shift. So what is a paradigm shift? I love the simple dictionary.com explanation. It talks about old habits being replaced by new ones, and those new habits will sooner or later settle into a normal routine for you. And then the second part is a major shift in the way you see the world. And I want to caution you, you are allowed to make fun of me. I am going to present different things to you that you may not have ever thought about before, and I'm giving you permission to disagree with me, but once I'm inside your head, you can never get me out again. So now we're going to go on a little bit of a ride. We're going to look at some tools. but can you really see things differently? With this picture, I'll give you a second or two, focus on it, and what do you see, or who do you see? If we were in a real live classroom, you would be talking with me about what you see. And almost every audience has come up with the right answer. There is, in fact, an old woman and a young woman in this picture. So the old woman, when you look at the entire picture, the bulk of it is her face. I've outlined where her face is. You're mostly seeing her left eye. You see her chin down in her chest. Now close your eyes, shake your head, and now let's look at it again. The same picture this time is the left profile of a woman who has a feather in her hair, and she's turned, and you're now seeing a very strong left profile and a choker in her neck. Once you're able to see both faces in this picture, you'll always be able to see it, and you'll never be able to not see both again. I said we're going to take a look at your current state of business. One of my favorite things to do is to analyze a team's annual revenue year over year, and I really like to look at 5 years. If you were to chart your last 5 years of revenues, what would the chart look like? Might it be an upward, but then a crash and burn? That happened one time with a team that I was working with. They had implemented some new best practices for prospecting and gaining new clients, but they were so successful and it took so much work that it wasn't sustainable. So they gave up. So they did great. And they went, nope, we can't do this. Boom, they stopped doing it. In another team that I worked with, it was a flat line. And I was in the gentleman's physical office. And as I looked around, there were pictures of his family where the wife was no longer in the pictures. So I asked him what had happened in his life. And his wife had passed away due to cancer. And it not only killed her, it killed him and his business. So looking at that flat line, we had to work on his head and his heart before we could ever look at the business. Speaking of business, do you have a true and real business plan with real attainable goals? And is it for potentially 3 to 5 years? Now, the reason I say real business plan, and Rick and I have joked about this before, quite often we will create a business plan for our boss, for maybe the firm director, for maybe the manager of the location where we're working. But it's not really the kind of business plan that we want to do our business with, because we don't want to let someone down. We don't want to say, we're going to grow this much and then miss it. So we have a tendency to do incremental growth for the manager's business plan. But in real life, I want you to take off the reins and think in terms of, if you're a $750,000 revenue generating partner, maybe you want to be $2 million. Well, why not? Why not think that way now? And I'm going to give you a couple of tips on how you might be able to start to outline a 3-year plan. This is so important. Analyze every single client once a year. I want you to give yourself the gift of time. Give yourself one full business day a year, where you do a deep dive into your business, you look at the 80-20 rule, you look at your business plan, and you look at each client, and you look at the client from a time perspective. We all have skills, talents, things that we're great at, things that we love to do. And we prefer to work with people that we actually like working with. So if you were to look at time, and not a normal time in billing, have every member on the team keep track of how much time did they spend answering phones, because this is one of those productivity things. Client calls in, you take care of it, you're off the phone. It may not have taken that long, but if this client is calling you, say, 10 times a month, 20 times a quarter, and you're not making any money, they're always nickel and diming the fees, is that a profitable client? Now, on the flip side, I want you to look at some of your smaller clients that you know you're keeping on the book. If I were to challenge you, what's the justification? In a lot of cases, it's a source of referrals. It's someone who can generate at least one referral per month that you can count on as a new client. It could also be your niece and nephew, and you don't dare disappoint your brother or sister. So as long as it's justified, you can keep the smaller clients, but you have to be business-minded about it. Client acquisition. This is one of my favorite activities, but I do it through referrals. There is an article in those two slides that I gave you that discusses specifically prospect pipeline during the age of coronavirus. So take a look at that one with client acquisition. I'm going to discuss client acquisition using client feedback and gaining referrals. So since we're talking about the current state of your business, think about it from the client's perspective. No one cares how much you know until they know how much you care. Right now with coronavirus, this is a great time to touch your clients, stay top of mind, make more connections with them. They really want to know how much you care about them during this crisis. But think about big picture. Why do you do what you do? What's in it for you to be in this business, to have the career that you have? Make sure you think about this on an annual basis. I know Rick has a thought or two from a philosophical point of view. Do you want to chime in, Rick?
That philosophically, these are good questions, not just to ask clients, but to ask yourself and what you want from your business, from your practice, from the efforts that you put in. And that helps define your future and how effective you'll be at carrying out any strategy that you want to put in place.
Thank you, Rick. Appreciate it. So why do you do what you do? What are your life goals and dreams? What do you want for your clients? And by all means, turn these clients around or these questions to your clients on an annual basis. So the Kennedy Factor paradigm shift, the first item is the calendar. This is one of those times where I'm going to introduce you to something and you're going to go, what? But give it a couple of seconds and I think you'll understand the wisdom of it from a client's perspective and how easy it is to get through a full year. The family tree also applies to our businesses. Mother Nature readiness is huge, especially right now, it's hurricane season, and then client retention best practices. So the calendar. This is a normal calendar. I got it from a Google template. It's got your four quarters. We all are used to January through March 31st for the first quarter. But as people, especially in the United States, do we really care that it's March 31st? Or does March 31st come and go and we don't even notice? It's because looming large is April 15th. If you think about it, every one of us are grown adults. We have to pay taxes. We know that April 15th is looming large for us at the beginning of every year. So what is the first quarter? January 1 to April 15th. And I've outlined the holidays and events that are happening in that particular quarter. Now, here it is, April 15th. We're relieved. We either did our taxes or we took extensions. And now our mind starts to drift to spring. Spring vacations. How about the spring vacations with your children? Maybe even summer vacations. So think about summer for a second. In the United States, we have two unofficial marking points. The first one is Memorial Day. The other one is Labor Day. So if we inherently think about summer, Memorial Day to Labor Day, that's our third quarter, and that forces a short second quarter. The second quarter is the day after taxes, April 16th to Memorial Day. And then fast forward to our fourth quarter, it's now Labor Day to December 31st. And I don't know about you, but I, even though I never had children, I am still hardwired that getting back to school mentality, getting back to work, the summer is over, it's the fall. We all get geared up again. What were our goals for the year? What else do we have to do to accomplish them? So we're going to look at this calendar a little bit later and how to use it for business plans. In fact, one of the best business plan tips that I can tell you at this point is to take, I always want things to be easy, because if it's not easy, you won't do it. And if you think about my logo, I don't know if you've noticed that there's a sunrise in it. The way my philosophy is about education is whatever I tell you today, you can implement tomorrow. So let's say tomorrow you get up and you get three sheets of flip chart paper. On each of the three, draw the quarters and just write January 1, April 15th, all the way through the four quarters. And now you've got a layout for a three-year business plan. Then you can use post-it notes and start to outline what it is that you want to accomplish and when. And all it takes is three pieces of flip chart paper. So how else can we look at the calendar? Well, in order to create a quarter, we have to look at the daily, weekly, and monthly. So I am a strong believer in time blocking. When you look at the calendar, in order to time block properly, I have to build in those things that I cannot change, the things that I cannot control. Maybe I'm locked into a certain lunch hour, either out of habit or because of my colleagues. Maybe there's an office meeting that is once a week at the same time. I can't change that. I come from a wealth management background, financial services. We had compliance deadlines for the stock market and banking deadlines. So we had to layer those into our day. Once you have those things outlined, now what I want you to do from a time blocking perspective, when are you at your best and when are you tired and a little dangerous, and start to time block. For me personally, and Rick has gotten to know this about me, I am very much a morning person. I am up at about 4 o'clock every day. I'm usually on the laptop by five, and I am a beast hard worker from about five until 2:30 or three. I've been sitting at the laptop, loving the work, totally dedicated, but now I think I need to have breakfast, or maybe I need to have lunch. And that intensity carries me through Friday. So by Friday afternoon, I'm a little tired and a little dangerous. So I try not to do anything customer facing after 3 o'clock on a Friday. So what am I going to do with that time? That's what I'm going to do, administrative work. That's what I'm going to do, some filing, anything that keeps me away from a customer. Now, here's the most critical part. So far, we're taking care of you. Now I want to make sure you take care of your teammates. I want everybody on the team to do this same activity and then share it with each other. Because if I'm going to be dedicated in the morning to project work, you might need me to help you out and cover, I know this sounds silly, but maybe cover your phones for you on a Wednesday afternoon when you need a time block. So that's why I want you to share the calendar with each other to get buy-in and cooperation. All right, here's the family tree. I use the Kennedy family as an example. We're going to pretend this is us. It's not. Mom and dad are your client. They're 81 and 85, and they've been your client for probably 30, maybe even 40 years. They have four grown adults. Each of the four are married, and there's eight grandchildren. Of the four adults, there's an awful lot of business activity. There's a lot of careers in play. There's a lot of home ownership and home selling. There's even vacation homes that have been purchased by the four Kennedy girls. The next layer is the grandkids. The first three grandchildren, who are my nieces, they are all college graduates. They are all working. And the first one is married and already bought a new house. The second one is engaged and is closing on her house this week. And the third one is a special needs school teacher. The reason I'm saying this is, of the four Kennedy girls and the eight nieces, especially the three that are working, who is doing their taxes? Are you doing their taxes? Because you know somebody is. Their families are complicated. I'm still pretty easy. I'm just married. We don't have any children. So we're pretty easy on the tax side. But I've had the same tax accountant for over 35 years. If he retires, I'm in trouble. But what happens if I die? He's going to lose that small amount of revenue that he gets from me. So that's the point. When Mr. and Mrs. Kennedy die, you now lose that revenue. But when you're looking at this family tree, you're missing out on the next two layers of potential revenue by not taking care of the family tree. So how do we apply this to your business clients? Well, as soon as I started working with an accounting firm, a lot of the partners, in fact, it was a common theme in my first 2 weeks of working there, was client retention is critically important to them, and we had something at risk. And the relationship that was at risk with our business clients is, most of the time, the partners only knew the CFO. And what they told me is CFOs have a tendency to change jobs every 3 to 5 years, maybe even 7 years. So what happens to your book of business when the CFO leaves this sample org chart? I was told you lose this business client, and now you're treading water trying to make those revenues back. So here's a great excuse to use COVID. Use COVID as an excuse to get to know the org chart. Get to know sales and marketing. You never know who they might know to introduce you to. Get to know the president. But here's awesome. Awesome tip. Board of directors. Get to know the board of directors, because you would like to have their businesses be your client. So you want to have a relationship with the board of directors, but what you really want to do is have their business in your book of business. All right, hurricane readiness. Rick and I just experienced this last week. We had a hurricane blow through. I live in Norfolk, Virginia, and he lives in Long Island. So I was able to tell him what we were experiencing at 1, 2, and 3 o'clock in the morning, and we had 10 tornadoes in the Hampton Roads area. So I was able to give Rick the heads up. Look, you're going to get some winds, you're going to get some rain, but man, you might get hit with a lot of tornadoes with this one. Now, how does this apply to your clients? How do you show how much you care? Well, with Mother Nature readiness, especially during hurricane season, think about where your clients are. Are they close to the water? Where are their businesses located? If they've got multiple locations, are any of them near water? Are they in the path of hurricanes? Well, the best way to keep an eye on your clients is the NOAA website. they've got that beautiful cone tracking. So what you can do to insert yourself into this is take a look at the hurricane readiness kit. It always refers to first aid kits, flashlights, batteries, waters, bottle of water. You can put your logo on the water and give your client a case of water. This way they know how much you care. You can put it on a first aid kit. You can put it on a flashlight. This way when the client is in need of help, they're thinking of you and how much you care for them. And I'm not saying anything astronomical. You could do $20, $25. Look at Staples, Office Depot. Look at Vistaprint and even Four Custom Print. But take a look at the different websites and see which one matches your budget and which one you would want to use. So here's some additional best practices. And I said we'd look at the calendar again. So we are going to use this calendar, and I say we, Rick and I am going to use the other three quarters as a blog for part of the follow-up to this webinar. But if you look at the first quarter, and it could take some planning now to get ready for it, these are some activities that could be happening during the first quarter of 2021 when your behavior is changing. The New Year's resolutions, think about this between you and your client, but also your client and their clients. Feel free to apply this information to your own clients in addition to your business. The one I really want to emphasize is the quarterly review with clients. I've already talked about 80-20. Do I want you to do a quarterly review with every one of your clients? No, I do not. If you are not already segmenting your book of business, you need to. Not all clients are created equally. Remember what I said about profitability and what I said about being justified? Take a look at the one that I highlighted, the reviews. Silver client might be on the smaller side. Rick and I discussed different revenue breakups. At my old firm, our bronze and silver clients, bronze was under 2,500, silver was 2,500 to 25,000, and this is in annual revenue, annual fees. Gold was 25 to 75, which is a big swing, and platinum was 75,000 and above. So if you think about silver and bronze, an annual review is fine. You can offer it face-to-face or on the phone, and in the age of coronavirus, think about everybody's health with this face-to-face concept. Gold, you're getting more money from them. Maybe you do two face-to-face, maybe you do two on the phone because you are doing quarterly. And on platinum, let them tell you. You're going to offer quarterly, but let them guide you as to the face-to-face or on the telephone, however your big clients. They're going to be part of the decision-making when you look at how often to contact them. Did you have anything that you wanted to add, Rick?
It's a terrific way to organize your clients by priority and to really understand the clients that you like working with and that are good to work with in a number of different metrics. And in doing this process, you also come to grips with the clients you don't like to work with, clients that are weighing you down, the clients that are driving you and your staff crazy.
I will tell you, as a little ad lib, I worked with a team out in California when I was still at Merrill Lynch. And it was two women working one-on-one together. It was the lead financial advisor with the client associate. They were both in their 40s. And if you have not made it to your 40s yet, you might not understand this. But there's something about being in your 40s where quality of life dominates your decision-making. So these two women decided they were going to examine their book of business based on all the things that I had taught them, but they were going to layer in one more thing. They wanted to have clients that were nice and they liked them. So they cut their book of business in half, and in 1 year, they doubled their business with half the amount of clients. So just tossing that in there, nice clients will work nicely with you. They'll take advantage, or not take advantage, they will take your advice, and they will refer people to you. Just a little food for thought on what you could do. Now, normally, face-to-face meetings, these would be the best practices, but in the world of coronavirus, we have to take it very, very strongly. If you've got clients who really do want to be face-to-face or you want to be face-to-face with them, please wear a mask. Put everybody 6 feet apart. Think about your conference rooms. You have to rearrange chairs and tables. Do whatever it takes. Have sanitizing spray, sanitizing liquid, anything to keep you and your clients healthy and safe. So if you are going to be face-to-face and you are going to be in a conference room, you are the host or hostess. Please do not use styrofoam cups. Please use real glasses, real plates. When I say real napkins, I mean a nice paper napkin. not a piece of paper towel. You don't have to use cloth napkins. You can work with your team members, have them go in and talk to the client. And one of the things that's really important is to debrief with your team after the meeting so everybody knows what the next steps are and you start to build that into your client, your calendar. So at the beginning of this, I told you that CPA Trendlines had a tip for us about Zoom meetings. And before I show you their do's and don'ts, I grabbed this from Google. Think about how you want to portray yourself to your clients. There's a couple of people in here that I don't think they're CPA accountants working with business clients. Think about this from a theatrical point of view. I was an assistant director and stage manager for 15 years of my 25 years in theater. Think of this as a theatrical production. There's lighting, there's costumes, there's makeup, there's hair, there's the setting. Look at the background of some of these. Rick and I actually coordinated ourselves on purpose. I asked him what color he thought he was going to wear. He said blue. I'm in blue. I have a tendency to like to wear blue on the Zoom meetings because this is my home office. My walls are blue and I have pictures of water. So the blue theme works well for me when I'm trying to have a nice polished background for the people that I do Zoom meetings with. Zoom itself has best practices, and this light has become very popular, this round ring light. I recently read a Wall Street Journal article that talked about this particular light, but they gave a tip that if you have a big lamp, you know, any kind of lamp, a standing lamp, put it behind the camera of your laptop and put a white sheet over it, because what you're trying to do is diminish shadows. You want to have a nice soft light and diminish shadows, and the white pillowcase seems to work. Now, here's the article from CPA Trendlines. They were so generous. There are 36 do's and don'ts. So here's three from the don't, and here's three that match with the theatrical background. Look at your bookshelf. Make sure that all of the books themselves are business friendly. I actually had to remove a picture of my dad this morning. My camera was aimed a little bit differently. It was when he was 18 years old and in the Navy. So I didn't think that that would be particularly great. So I put dad to the side today. Now, this is one of my favorite topics. I told you about client acquisition from referrals. Hopefully you are asking your clients for feedback. When I was with the accounting firm, I was responsible for the net promoter process. We did surveys and we did interviews. And as the client experience director, I was the only one that sent those surveys and I was the only one that did the interviews. So you've got to look at feedback as a gift. Do not be afraid of detractors. If you're using NPS, you're using that scale of 0 to 10. If a client, even though they're mad, they've taken the time to fill out your survey, they gave you a 0, which is heartbreaking, and they've told you a story, breathe and appreciate the fact that they're still your client. They took the time to complain and now do a paradigm shift. Those clients are begging for help and support with the back of their head saying, don't make me find another CPA. Don't make me take 20 years of history with this team to another firm. Please rescue me. Send me a lifeline. So think about the feedback, the good, the bad, and the ugly. You want engaged clients. You want them to tell you the truth versus sneaking out the back door. Now, on the other side is my favorite, your nines, your tens, your promoters, your raving fans. You asked them, would you recommend us? And the client said, a 10 with an exclamation point. I got an 11. I got a 25 one time looking at the surveys. The clients are capital letters. They're doing exclamation points. They are saying they love you. Now, what are you doing with your promoter? Are you saying thank you? And that's all you're doing? Or are you thinking about the recommendation that you could get from your promoter? Now, the onus is on you to be prepared of who you want to meet. If you tell the promoter, oh my gosh, we love you too. Thank you so much for the feedback. Who do you have in mind that you could refer to us? Your client is not going to do anything. Your client is going to say, well, let me think about it. And now you've missed the opportunity. So here's the burden on you. Who is your ideal client? Who is your niche market and who do you love to work with? Let's say you love working with CFOs in the healthcare industry. You need to do a little bit of homework on your promoter client. Maybe look in their LinkedIn page. Maybe look at their board of directors. See if you can ferret out any CFOs in healthcare. And now when you call your client, You thank them for their feedback. We love you too. We love working with the decision makers, the CFOs. You know how much we love healthcare. Could you introduce us to Rick, Eileen, and George? Now you've made it very easy for the client to say, of course, let's have lunch, let's have drinks. I'd love to introduce you. You've made it easy for the client to do the introduction. You did the thinking for them. Let me know if you have any questions. Email me, do the chat box. I also want to give you some book recommendations. I know this is a lot of information. I'm asking you to think a little bit differently. These are some of my favorite books from client experience and business development. And when I am in a coaching environment where I'm coaching a team, usually 90 days to 6 months, it's really sweet if it can last a full year. The two books that I highlighted are mandatory reading for everybody. I got introduced to these two books in 1996, and I reread them every single year. And when something changes in my life, I reread them again. Like whether my job changed, whether I got married, whether I got downsized due to the coronavirus, I will reread these books at least once a year. The main thing is it gets inside your head, the way you think about your business plans. Don't think about incremental growth. What do you really want? And let it be known in the universe. Take the reins off yourself. That's why I want you to read those two books. What's going to be happening next? I've already mentioned it. I'm going to continue to work with Rick. We're going to do monthly blogs. We're going to blow out the fall and then start to blow out the rest of the year for you. So hopefully you'll see these soon. I know we're going to be sensitive to the September 15th and October 15th tax deadlines. And now I will turn it back over to Rick. Thank you so much for having me here today.
Thank you, Eileen Kennedy, for what's a terrific presentation. It covered the waterfront in terms of managing client experience in the age of COVID.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, we have some questions if you want to go into some detail on a couple things. One of them was how to go beyond your engagement contact in any given organization, whether it's a company or a family. How to get that introduction or that permission to go to a board of directors or the marketing and sales team or the manufacturing team as opposed to just the finance team?
You use the key word, permission. Because you want to have more than just the finance people as your relationships, you want to now meet more than just the CFO. So you're a professional and you're going to meet the CEO who's also a professional. Maybe you have a Zoom call like this. Maybe you have a lunch meeting where you're 6 feet apart. Somehow, while you're building the relationship and you're talking about the business as a whole and how to position yourself as a business partner, you can bring up the board of directors and see how the CEO responds. If you're approaching it in a true care of the business, and because of COVID, the client has already started to see you a little bit differently, perhaps the CEO can continue that conversation. You've teed it up very gently. See where the CEO takes it. But permission is key because you don't want to rock the boats on their relationships with their board of directors.
So COVID gives us permission to do things that we might not have felt comfortable doing before.
Absolutely.
What kinds of things does COVID give us permission to do now?
Very proactive contact. Mm-hmm. Very proactive contact. How are you doing? How's the health of you and your family? How are the health of the other employees? How is your business surviving? Depending on what industry you have a niche in, oh my heavens, if it's like the restaurants and hospitality, sometimes you're just going to be the therapist to have them have a safe place to talk. But if you've got some other industries, like healthcare is booming right now, use empathy to lead. And you really care about the person, the person's family, and their employees, where you might not have ever led with your heart before, this is the perfect time to do it. You're behaving differently because of COVID. And everybody understands it because we're all going through the same thing at the same time. But I will caution you about Zoom fatigue. I love to read, I love to learn, I love to stay current. And there are a lot of articles that I've been reading in, say, the last 2 weeks about employee Zoom fatigue, because the boss is wanting to stay in touch with the employees, so they're doing Zoom meetings, and they're doing collaborative Zoom meetings instead of the old-fashioned conference calls that they used to have. So I caution you with Zoom fatigue, but definitely proactively stay in touch with your clients.
One more question.
Sure.
And that is, in the age of COVID, how do we do an appreciation event?
Let me go back to that slide. All right, so here's the client segmentation model, and down towards the bottom, there is appreciation events. I was in charge of the appreciation events in Manhattan when I was the business manager at Merrill Lynch for the New York City District, and there was no such thing as social distancing. They were for 1,000 people every quarter for 4 years. Now, you have to get very, very creative. I would actually start to shift gears and use some of the tricks that I learned from Texas. Texas was very creative when it came to their appreciation events, and now I might go back to some of their ideas and apply COVID to them. And in fact, I saw something on the Today Show this morning where they're talking about the old-fashioned drive-in movie theaters and having, you know, concession stands available. You could potentially do something like that. There was one team in Texas that every Christmas, and now think about the family tree and how you want to get to the next generation. This team showed It's a Wonderful Life in a movie theater for his clients, their families, and bring a friend. Bring your best friend and their families. And what it allowed the financial advisor to do was be Santa Claus without the beard. So everybody actually knew who he was. He was pretending. So now he's got everybody in a lovely, fun environment. He's supplying the barbecue. Now, if I start to think about how to do this in a COVID environment, there are movie theaters that have got tables and chairs. There's one here in Norfolk where you go, you have your dinner, you have your cocktail, and you watch a movie. You can really set up some kind of social distancing with that. While I'm thinking about it, how about your local restaurants? When you get a private room, think about Ruth Chris or Morton Steakhouse. You can social distance there. You can have smaller groups of people and the tables spread out where you bring a family in to have an event. Maybe it's a talk. When you think about appreciation events, one of the other things that we did, this is with the calendar. Here, take a look at this. With the wealth and health seminars, one of the things that we did in New York was we did a series of our platinum clients, but you had to have $25 million invested with Merrill Lynch in order to be invited to these special events. And the health and wealth seminar was all about your heart and your health. So we had the anniversary cookbooks from the American Heart Association autographed by the cardiologist that was the speaker that we brought in. So we were saying, you are so important to us that we are looking out for your health. We were in a restaurant. We didn't have to social distance back in the late 90s, but think about having separate tables and bringing in a guest speaker. You can always use your masks. You can always use the 6 feet, and you can always use your sanitizer. Hopefully, these are a couple of ideas that you might be able to try.
Those are perfect creative ideas. Thank you very much, Eileen.
You're welcome.
I think that does it for today. Any final words for our audience?
No, just good luck. This is a tough time in all of our lives. We're all in it together. Do whatever it takes to motivate yourself so you can get through another day and be positive and proactive and know that your clients need you. So I hope that helps a little bit.
Good words to follow. Eileen Kennedy, Rick Telberg for CPA Trendlines. Thank you very much.
Thank you.